So hello everyone, my name is Dr. Sam Hurst, and you can find me on Twitter at RomGothSam. If you're live tweeting or if you're going to be talking about the talk, you can tag me in it at RomGothSam, and or you can use the hashtag RomancingTheGothic so it's easier for people to find. The talk today is Sexy Satan, What Have You Done? And if people have been following me on Twitter for a while, you might know where the idea of this talk came from, in conjunction with another class that I did about Paradise Lost and Frankenstein. I did a little thread that I thought would be like a little nice fun thing of different, quite sexy representations of Satan in history. And it was quite popular. So I thought perhaps there's enough interest in this to make a class out of it and to go a little bit deeper into what's going on with the representation and depiction of Satan. I've called it a partial history of demonic representation for a couple of different reasons. The first reason is that I'm going to be concentrating on a particular religious tradition, the Christian tradition, and I'm particularly going to be thinking about sort of Western Christianity in sort of the Anglophone world more broadly. Now, there is going to be, of course, crossover, but I'm wanting to sort of state that I'm not trying to give a universal history here. Also, of course, we're looking at a couple of thousand years of history here, so it's only going to be partial. There's not the opportunity to go in depth on all of it. I am going to look at three different sort of time periods in the talk today. So for the first section, we're going to be looking at Satan in the cultural imaginary more broadly, and where our ideas of the satanic and our sort of visual representations of the satanic come from. We're also going to be looking then in the second section, we're going to be concentrating in my area of expertise in the late 18th and early 19th century, and we're going to be thinking about Satan as a subversive figure and the subversive potential for Satan in four different areas: theology, politics, gender and sexuality, and race. And in the last section, I'm going to look relatively briefly at three modern case studies and looking at the depiction of Satan and asking this question, well, Satan, what have you become? How do we see the fruition of these legacies of depiction of Satan and subversion via the figure of Satan in modern media? So, as I've mentioned already, we're thinking about Satan in the cultural imaginary. So what I'm not doing today is giving you an in-depth theology of Satan or trying to pick out the demonologies which either existed or exist today around Satan. Rather, we're looking at Satan as a figure that appears in the cultural imaginary, that appears in literature, art, and popular culture. Now, of course, it's interwoven with the theology, but when I'm not doing a theological dissection here and attempting to come up with truth claims about the satanic. So bearing this in mind, this is the interaction bit. This is the bit where I want to see the chat. And the question is, who is Satan to you? What is the Satan that exists in your imaginary, in your imagination? There's a couple of ways you could answer this, some sort of thoughts. What does he look like? What's his story? And what does he signify? So if you just put in the chat, as I say, no wrong answers, because it's just the impressions that you have of sort of Satan as a figure. What does Satan mean to you? I'm going to open the chat so I can see and pause the recording. Yeah, there's various different sort of understandings and ideas of Satan that sort of coexist and continue to the sort of older models and what you might think of as older and newer models, but they actually continue to coexist together. And there are a lot of different attached meanings, and I'm not going to be able to cover them all today. What I'm looking at is sort of larger trends. And sort of to that end, I popped on this slide a couple of the sort of perhaps most prominent images and imaginations, sort of imaginaries around the satanic figure. So this is the Satan from Dante Alighieri's The Inferno, for example, this kind of man monster. Sort of literary paradigms are really influential in our understanding of Satan. We have Paradise Lost, for example, and that Byronic emo hero, tragic figure. Somebody mentioned the man in red with the horns. This is from that sort of dating ad spoof with Ryan Reynolds as the demon. And we still have that existing demonic iconography from a sort of this earlier iconography. Lucifer, this idea of the sort of the modernized devil, particularly sort of passable as human and usually quite suave, quite sexy, quite attractive. And also one of the sort of latest examples, which is where another of my threads came from, this idea of Satan as sort of an avatar of rebellion or of resistance to cultural norms. But where do any of these ideas of Satan come from? Where do our ideas of Satan come from? The sort of answer that leaps to the mind potentially for people when they are sort of confronting this question is, well, these ideas about Satan come from the Bible, of course. But that's not really, strictly speaking, that accurate. There are actually very few biblical passages which deal with Satan. Many of the passages that we find in the Bible discuss Satan as a tempter, trickster, deceiver. So we have the idea of Satan as a roaring lion. We have the temptations of Satan of Jesus in the desert, for example. But all of that sort of backstory of Satan and the satanic story is drawn from a couple really isolated verses, which are taken from different places. And how did these verses inform our understanding of Satan and also inform our depiction of the satanic? Now, this is one of the first depictions of Satan, probably Satan, dating back to the 6th century. It's a mosaic from the Basilica of San Apollinare Nuovo in Ravenna, Italy. And which of these figures is Satan, do you think? My left or Jesus's left? It's always the goats. Yes, Ali. So in our sort of imaginary state, we've already mentioned, we often associate the satanic and the devil with red, but in these earlier, in these medieval as well, kind of register of the demonic, the devil is often portrayed in blue. In this mosaic here, you're reverting back to, there's reference to the sort of the judgment seat and the way in which Christ will separate the sheep from the goats. And as we know, it's always the goats that are on the satanic side, on the side of damnation. So it is the figure on our right, on Jesus's left, that is the satanic figure. And as you can see here, there's very little difference between this figure and the one on the other side. Apart from color, the expression, the pose, the accoutrements are very similar. So obviously we have here this idea of Jesus as the fallen angel. And somebody asked in the chat about the quotes that are relevant. I'm going to go through them, don't worry. So you've got these particular verses, which is where a lot of this kind of narrative of Satan is drawn from. One of the most famous is, of course, Jesus himself saying in Luke 10:18, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." And we sort of have this idea already encoded in that little snippet of this idea of the fallen angel. Now, this is combined with the prophetic text in Isaiah 14, this idea of the morning star, son of the dawn, who said, "I will ascend to heaven, I will raise my throne above the stars of God, I will sit enthroned," who through pride attempted equality with God. So this is another sort of bit that's brought in to particularly modern understandings of the satanic. Then you have the apocryphal text to Enoch. So that's not in sort of the Old and New Testaments as accepted by, for example, Protestant churches, majority of Protestant churches, but is instead from the Apocrypha, those sort of extra texts, as it were. This is perhaps the clearest sort of echo of the story which we usually associate with Satan, and one from out of the order of angels, having turned away with the order that was under him, conceived an impossible thought to place his throne higher than the clouds above the earth, that he might become equal in rank to my power. And I threw him out from the height with his angels, and he was flying in the air continuously above the bottomless pit. We also draw from a couple of different passages in Revelation, but this is the one that I've just brought up here. This idea again of the plummeting star, the falling angel. You can see how this is influencing the depiction. Now, we have a move, particularly in the medieval period, towards a slightly different form of depiction. And it's tied in with, as well, all of these other sort of narratives of the satanic. So as I mentioned at the beginning, many of the sort of New Testament mentions of Satan or the devil, the Antichrist or Lucifer, or any of these terms which can sometimes be conflated, but which we could at length sort of discuss and discourse about. they become sort of associated with this idea of false testimony, deception, and temptation. And we find, for example, in Matthew 4, this is the temptation of Jesus in the desert. And we have the depiction here from this altarpiece from the 14th century. And you can see in the figure of of Satan or of the devil, the remains of the archangelic or the angelic sort of imagery of the wings, but you're already getting a sort of slightly more creaturely version of that. You're also getting this depiction of a black Satan. And we will find sort of throughout history, this conflation of a really racialized demonology with depictions of the devil. The other sort of association that we have with the devil, of course, is his placement and this idea of Satan's relationship to hell. Now, as you can see from the biblical passage, we have this idea of the devil being thrown down into this fiery pit, rather than this kind of narrative that we seem to cling to, or that's very frequent today, of the sort of ruler and prince of hell, who's really in control of that space. But you can definitely see in the picture how we have this much more bestial demonic figure. We have these claw feet, we have the weird, you know, face stomach, we have the animal ears and the horns and the claws, the bat wings, rather than the feathered angelic wings. So where does this particular sort of visual imaginary of the devil come from? Well, we've got sort of a variety here of medieval examples of demonic depiction. And you'll see these sort of features coming up again. We have this sort of animalistic, these various body parts that are out of place. And there's a couple of reasons behind the different depictions here. So some of the common ones are the fact that many of these visualizations of the demonic are actually about the way in which other religious narratives and other religions have been subsumed within a Christian orthodoxy, or as Jonathan O'Donnell, who is here, it's also a Christian orthotaxy, i.e. the right ordering or an understanding of a right understanding of the ordering of the world. So instead of being their own gods, they become within a Christian sort of cosmology demons, and aspects of their depiction are integrated into the depiction of the demonic within these sort of Christian medieval manuscripts. So the easiest sort of example to think of here is the sort of the idea of the satyr legs, the furred legs and the cloven hooves at the bottom, which are a fairly obvious echoing of that sort of the satyr, and obviously of the sort of Bacchanalian god Pan. Another sort of key feature of these depictions that you'll note are these faces that are everywhere. So what's that about? Well, within the sort of Christian cosmology of the period, you have this idea of the devil is basically an avatar of disorder. What he is disorder, a challenge to the divine ordering of the world. And therefore, because he is sort of his emblem of disorder, he has in himself a disordered body. The top is the bottom. So he has a face on his butt, basically. And this is a really common depiction. And you get it in the sort of the simpler version that we have on the left, where it's just simply a butt. And then we have it in the more ornate version on the right, which is lots and lots of faces all over his disordered body. But the question becomes, how do we move from this kind of medieval Catholic imagination, from these bestial demons with their face arses? How do we move from that to something like this? The modern imaginary, one item within the modern imaginary of a sort of satanic figure. Just to be clear about where I'm sort of articulating we're going from and to, we're moving from this idea of the devil, and you can possibly see the picture in the background there. We have the Virgin Mary punching the devil in the face. But we have this move from the devil as monstrous, as a tempter and deceiver, a predator, bestial, disordered in his body, often farcical, as in that Virgin Mary painting of being the devil being punched in the face, and sort of universally dangerous or attempting to pose a danger. Now, these meanings don't entirely disappear. As you could see when I asked you about Satan in your sort of imaginary or in your imagination, many of these still apply to our understandings of Satan. But in the sort of the modern imaginary, we also have room for a very, very different conception of the satanic that you can see, hopefully you can see a little bit in the background there, this photograph by Federico Ferro of Lucifer. Well, not of the actual Lucifer, obviously, of a model from 2020. And this particular imagination, this idea of Satan as a sympathetic figure, not simply a tempter, but in himself tempting, a tortured figure and a victim of obvious, usually a sort of divine tyrant, a sort of emblem of resistance and of freedom, sexy rather than simply sexual, and thrilling as well as dangerous. How do we get to the place where we have this type of Satan? These are some examples from Roberto Ferri, The Fallen Angel from 2011, and Lucifer from 2013. And you can see a lot of the characteristics that I discussed on the last page encoded here. We have the sexiness, most obviously, but we also have this sort of tortured, melancholic gaze. We have the positioning, not as a predator, certainly, but perhaps as the victim of predation. So how did we get there? How did we get to this cultural imaginary? Well, one of the main ways in which we see the sort of understanding and the narratives around the devil and Satan changing in the cultural imaginary is through literary influence. So many of the things that we take for granted as being our understandings or being part of the narrative of hell or of the devil are actually taken from literary sources, which in themselves were also being based on contemporary theology, contemporary sort of church doctrines. I'm going to look at three examples here. One of the most famous is, of course, I've already mentioned it, Dante Alighieri's The Divine Comedy, particularly the Inferno, and that conception of the rings of hell and the different levels of hell for different sins. In it, you have Satan as this gigantic figure trapped in ice with three heads, each of a different color, each one eating people, as you can see in the picture here. What's quite interesting, I think, is when we start to look at the depiction of this demonic figure. Now, Dante Alighieri wrote the Divina Commedia in 1320, but by the time we're looking at sort of this Renaissance depiction in the late 1590s to 1600s, we can see some interesting features of change, essentially, in this demonic depiction. This is a full body picture, which is relatively unusual. He's still got his little chicken feet or little hawk feet at the bottom, and he's got his moth wings, his horns and his slightly crazy hair. But you also have this very fit, very molded, sculpted body. And what we're getting here in this depiction of Satan is this sort of interweaving and influence of the artistic paradigms of the time and the artistic interests of the time in the depiction of Satan. So I'm not an art historian, and art historians could go into this in a great deal more detail and with a great deal more nuance. This is very broad strokes. What we have here in the depiction of the satanic body is this attempt, both the a reflection of the Renaissance interest in anatomy and the attempt to depict anatomy accurately, broadly speaking, and it's also this kind of interest, the resurgent classical interest in sort of a conception of the perfect masculine body, which is being sort of intertwined with the demonic. And I think that we can see fairly clearly how this imagery becomes part of the satanic imaginary. Another sort of key text in thinking about the literary imagination and the rewriting or re-understanding of the satanic is the Faust narrative. Now, the original narrative is obviously from Germany, but sort of within the Anglophone world, the first sort of major source and influence is the tragical history of the life and death of Dr. Faustus by Christopher Marlowe. And I've used here the woodcut illustration from the title page here from 1631. So, visually speaking, here we don't have a great change in the demonic. We have the bat wings, we have the fairly sort of bestial features. We also have this idea of the black devil, a black demon once again reoccurring. But the text itself creates some sort of changes in narrative. So instead of having Satan as a roaring lion prowling around attempting to deceive everyone, we have this idea of the special case Faustian pact, the devil making deals with particular people. Now, this is obviously, of course, borrowing from the narrative of the witch's deal, the witch and the demonic deal, which itself was a sort of creation, obviously. But we are seeing this sort of shift slightly in how the demonic and the relationship between the demonic and the divine and the human is occurring through this motif of the demonic special case deal. Now, of course, sort of the major text, if we're thinking about reimaginings of the satanic and the creation of the cultural imaginary around the satanic, creation of narratives around the satanic, the major text that we can look at is John Milton's Paradise Lost from 1667. Now, it was written and published originally as a 10-volume poem that was later republished as 12 volumes. And in the original, what Paradise Lost is a theodicy, essentially. It's an attempt, according to the first lines, to explain God to man, to create sort of a story, both of the creation of the world and of the existence of evil. So it tells about the satanic rebellion in heaven, and many of the things that we sort of take as read about that rebellion and its consequences, the idea of pandemonium, for example, many of the sort of geographies of both heaven and hell come actually from this Miltonic imagination. So we have the fall of the rebel angels, and then we also have the fall of man being depicted in the text. Now, the first illustrations to this text appear in 1668. And there are three sort of key illustrators and one engraver who worked on this. So John Baptiste Medina, Henry Aldrich, and Bernard Lenz. Bernard Lenz did one of the pictures. It's sort of conceived that Henry Aldrich was the influence behind three, and John Baptiste Medina did the others. And there are only 12 pictures, one for each book. Now, as the art historian Alison Knirk notes, being the first illustrators of this major epic, Medina and Aldrich had to rely heavily on the well-known iconography of their time. So this is sort of an echo of what we saw with the depiction of the Inferno. What these artists were doing was using a demonic iconography, but also very much borrowing from the artistic field of their time, the artistic interests of their time, and also pre-existing work and models. And we'll have a look at one of those influences in a second. Also, we have this idea that the minimal descriptive clues given by Satan in the poem led him to develop a new image of Satan that personifies Milton's creation, because Milton didn't give a lot of physical detail. So the artists were attempting to create a new image that mapped onto both the sort of fairly scant physical details and the more obvious moral details of the depiction of the satanic. And these depictions set the precedent for many future artists in some ways. So we can have a look here at this idea of influence, and also in this idea of the creation of a sort of slightly new imaginary around the satanic. So this is the painting by Raphael of St. Michael slaying the dragon. And you can probably see some of the overlaps already, both in pose and detail between this. And it's Michael Berger's the engraver, the illustrator was Henry Aldrich, his Satan rousing the rebel angels. This would be 1668, sorry, not 1588. so you can see a number of details, and there's this emphasis on the particularly angelic form of the devil here. It does have these kind of consistent features that we've already seen in demonic depictions, the little pointy ears, the little horns, the wild sort of snaky hair. But in terms of the depiction of the rest of his body, in terms of the depiction of his costume and his stance, there's a borrowing here from other artistic traditions or other artistic sort of iconographies, including the angelic. Now, this image is one which I think the influence of it we can see in later depictions. And that's something that you can think about when we see them. But something that we find in this first sort of pictorial or visual imagination of Milton's Satan is something that we don't find in many of the others. That is, in the Paradise Lost poems, frequently in our modern imaginary, we really concentrate on books one and two. The defiant Satan standing in hell, standing in pandemonium and defying God, shouting his defiance to God. What we have within Milton's Paradise Lost, however, over the course of the 12 poems, is the degeneration of Satan, both morally and in form. Eventually, he returns back to the form of a serpent. And then he returns back to a sort of more humanized form, but his form degenerates, and his sort of the rotten core of his defiance is revealed within the text. So his defiance is shown to be a sort of pride and pettiness. He destroys humanity because of a wounded pride rather than as a sort of act of defiance or solidarity. And this idea that we find in the original poem, not in the rereadings that we're more familiar with of Satan that concentrate really on books one and two, but in the sort of original poem, you have this generation, and that is really mapped in the art that is produced by these illustrators and engraver. So the original image we have emphasizes the angelic form, the archangel ruined and the excess of glory obscured, and has these hints already of degeneration. This face, deep scars of thunder had entrenched in care sat on his faded cheek. And we also have this sort of idea of this moral ambiguity or moral layering, perhaps better expressed. So cruel his eye, but cast signs of remorse and passion to behold the fellows of his crime. Now it's the idea often of the remorse and passion which is picked up in modern reimaginings rather than this conception of cruelty. Anyway, if you look at the sort of visual imaginary, you can see the change from the illustration to book one to the illustration to book two. So gone are the feathered angelic wings, replaced with a more demonically coded bat wing. The ears have got pointier, the hair has got wilder. And although he's still dressed in the same clothes, there is this sort of move towards an older, more bestial depiction of the Satanic. We see this, as I've said, we have the degeneration of form ultimately to the form of the serpent again within the text. And you can see here in book three already the force of this degeneration. We have here Satan, he's got the tail, he's got the shaggy haired legs, he's not wearing the sort of Roman accoutrements anymore, and much sort of more similar to this kind of bestial goatish depiction of the Satanic. So as I say, this is something that we don't necessarily really find in many of the later illustrations, which are much more influenced by sort of rereadings of Milton that move away from that sort of, I'm not going to say theological orthodoxy because he wasn't theologically orthodox, but the broadly speaking theological orthodoxy of his conception of the evil of Satan as it's depicted within the narrative. But what we have in the 18th century particularly is a rereading of Milton, which focuses on books one and two, which focuses on sort of rewriting and rethinking the Satanic figure. In the discourse of the sublime, which proliferated in the 18th century, we have the devil tied to the sublime, with Edmund Burke, one of the key theorists, saying, you know, there is no more sublime description than this justly celebrated one of Milton's Satan, with a dignity so suitable to the subject. We have this idea not only of a sort of physical sublimity, but also of a moral sublimity to the devil appearing in this depiction of the vanquished rebel who refuses to be vanquished, who stands up against a man he denounces as tyrant. William Godwin suggests that the devil is a being of considerable virtue who bore his torments with fortitude because he disdained to be subdued by despotic power. And then we have this move to the idea of Satan as anti-hero. This is perhaps sort of most famously expressed in William Blake's comment about Milton, where he says the reason Milton wrote in fetters when he wrote of angels and gods and at liberty when of devils and hell is because he was a true poet and of the devil's party without knowing it. This reframes Milton's Paradise Lost as the story of Satan rather than the story of God or of man's fall. And it also depicts this idea of Satan, if not as the protagonist, and if not as the hero, as potentially the anti-hero of the piece. And all of these elements go into the rereadings that we will see, as I've said already, proliferating in that romantic period of the late 18th and early 19th century, which really turned our interpretation of the Satanic. or the possible interpretations of the satanic and the possible deployments and usages of satanic depiction. Now, we also see this visually. We see this rereading reflected visually. Now, already from 1749, you have the illustrations from Simon François Ravenet, who is, here you have this sort of martial, heroic pose for the satanic figure. Again, this emphasis on a physical perfection, the angel or the angelic wings. And although this is sort of the wildness of the hair and eyes, this is borrowing in terms of visual language from heroic and epic subjects. In terms of, you have in William Blake illustrated Paradise Lost himself, and you have, you know, some very clearly sublime imagery here, this emphasis on the sort of perfect masculine body again, this influence on the sort of charismatic and heroic figure of the satanic, even though you have these disruptive elements of that narrative in the sort of the pain and the torture of the demonic figures and the fire at the bottom of the picture, you still have this sublime Satan. And something that's quite sort of interesting or worth noting is that this kind of translation of Paradise Lost into a visual medium, essentially, it's not that it removes it from its literary or originating context, but what it does is it freezes certain moments and images, creating of them a language and an imaginary around the satanic. So Satan is forever frozen, essentially, in this artwork, in his position of sublimity. There's also some interesting subversions going on, I would say, in this picture of Satan and his snake floating above Adam and Eve. Although the snake is there to show his connection with their temptation and fall, both his positioning and the expression on his face seem to align him in sympathy, at least, with the human lovers. And there's this sort of emphasis on a sort of mournful expression, and this emphasis, as I've said already, on that sort of human demonic sympathy. This idea of Satan as a kind of heroic figure is picked up in much of the artwork that we'll see. We have J.P. Simon here, Satan leading the host, Henry Fuseli's depiction of the birth of sin and death. Again, this emphasis as well on the sort of the perfect male form. Gustave Doré moves us to a slightly different register in the 1840s. Here you have much more clearly this sort of tragic depiction, this tragic, heroic, almost Byronic depiction of a Satan who is unjustly punished. And the emphasis is really on that sort of imagery in this kind of visual representation. So this is the picture that I'm going to finish on for this section. And this is Alexander Cabanel's 1847 Fallen Angel. And I think it's a really good summary of where we're at by the mid 19th century in terms of the visual imaginary and the sort of theoretical imaginary around the satanic figure. So we have here Satan after his fall. He's naked, he's very sexy, he's very sort of angelic, there's this perfection to his physical form. There's also this kind of defiance, which comes across as petulance in this one, I have to say. But this kind of image of beauty, sublimity, and defiance is sort of a key part of where this rereading of the Miltonic Satan and its representation in art leaves us. So I'm going to finish the first section, come out. Sorry guys, I'm gonna have to say it again. So I'll fill it very briefly. We get different forms of subversion through the satanic in the Romantic period, theological, political, through of sexuality and race. So theologically, one of the key examples is Cain by Lord George Byron. And the story of Cain is the story of Cain, the first murderer. In this version, he's complaining against the unfairness of his punishment, the fact that he's been punished along with Adam and Eve for their sin. Lucifer comes, justifies his complaints, and then goes on to show him the world, deride and decry God as a tyrant who won't let Cain live, and who is afraid of Cain's potential to disrupt the divine order and to become like us. So we can see an example of that here in this speech by Lucifer as he's talking to Cain, who answers to the question of like, who are you? Saying, but souls who dare use their immortality, souls who dare look the omnipotent tyrant in his everlasting face and tell him that his evil is not good. If he is made as he saith, which I know not nor believe, but if he made us, he cannot unmake. We are immortal. Nay, he'd have us so that he may torture. Let him. He is great, but in his greatness is no happier than we in our conflict. Goodness would not make evil, and what else hath he made? But let him sit on his vast and solitary throne, creating worlds to make eternity, less burdensome to his immense existence, an unparticipated solitude. Let him crowd orb on orb. He is alone, indefinite, indissoluble tyrant. So in this particular speech, we obviously have sort of various points of theological subversion coming together. We have the idea of God, not as a benevolent deity, but as a manipulative tyrant, an indefinite, indissoluble tyrant. We have the idea of creation, not as an outpouring or an extension of his love or creative energies, but rather as a symptom of boredom. We have the essential idea of the cruelty of that creation and the cruelty of a God who creates immortal beings only to torture them. It decries kind of here the concept of hell and eternal punishment. We also have the questioning of theodicies and the idea of the introduction of evil. So it says he didn't create evil. Well, what else hath he made? Now, we could, along with Byron, say, oh, no, no, this isn't subversive at all. This is his defense when people critiqued him, because he said, well, you know, of course, it's Satan saying these things. So we know that he's wrong, right? But of course, what you have in Cain is you have this borrowing of the sublime Satan, both physically and morally, from Milton. And this sublimity is never, unlike in Milton, unlike in Paradise Lost, it's never dissolved, it's never diminished within the text. He remains the same throughout. He remains sublime. And he actually remains more sublime than Cain does. And we can see this again in the sort of visual imaginary around this particular work. The sort of sublimity of Satan reinforces this subversion rather than diminishing it. We also need to think about the ways in which this satanic figure was used in theopolitical and political subversion. Now, it's worth sort of thinking about the era in which these the romantics were operating and which these narratives and understandings were being produced in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. We have got, it's a period of revolution. We have the American Revolution, the French Revolution, the Corsican Revolution, the Haitian Revolution. We also have sort of the rise of working class activism within Britain and increased campaigns for universal suffrage. We have campaigns for toleration and the extension of both suffrage and toleration to Catholics, dissenters. We also have the rise of kind of feminist resistant discourse in writers like Mary Wollstonecraft. And we also have the concomitant crackdown on dissent and radical politics, which happens in the 1790s, in part as a response to the French Revolution, which was seen as being potentially dangerously infecting Britain with its violent radicalism. And that led to, so for example, the removal of habeas corpus. It led to a number of treason trials. It led to crackdowns on radical publications. And this is sort of the context in which this subversive Satan is getting deployed. And we can see in William Godwin, this is articulated very, very clearly in his Inquiry Concerning Political Justice. As the title suggests, it is an inquiry concerning political justice. It's a work of political philosophy, which looks at the way in which society works and critiques the current systems of management, governance, and ordering. And in this bit of political philosophy, it suddenly starts to talk about Milton's Satan and asks the question of why is he so admired? Well, he says, because of his attributes. Why did he rebel across his maker? It was, as he himself informs us, because he saw no sufficient reason for that extreme inequality of rank and power which the creator assumed. So what we have Godwin doing here is very, very clearly tying this Miltonic satanic figure with his own critiques of the inequalities of rank and power in the current society. So here we find Satan becoming aligned with oppressed and marginalized communities as an avatar of resistance. he says that it was because prescription and precedent form an inadequate ground for implicit faith. So he is arguing against and saying that Lucifer or Satan is a figure which stands against this idea that we can simply be told what to do because I'm telling you, because laws exist. It's also sort of arguing against these arguments from precedent that people like Ed Burke were producing in the 1790s, saying, well, the government has to stay as it is because that's our time-honored tradition and precedent. We also have this idea he's producing of Satan as hardly and injuriously treated. So again, Satan as having much in common with the oppressed and marginalized. Now, there's one thing that I draw out here just at the end, which I think is an interesting curtailment of this extension of sympathy, satanic sympathy, or rather empathy and identification. Because he says that because he has a sense of reason and justice that was stronger in his mind than a sense of brute force, because he had it of the feelings of an Epictetus or a Cato and little of those of the slave. So here, what Godwin is essentially doing is creating a barrier between those marginalized with whom, who can identify with Satan, and the enslaved, the most marginalized and oppressed within the society of the time, for whom Satan is not an avatar of resistance. And this kind of divide is something which will become destabilized and fractured later through later work, but it will take quite a long time for it to be fractured. And it's sort of an interesting thing to bear in mind when we go back to this question of racialized demonologies and the connections of race and the demonic imagery. So quick theory break, guys. For that last part, I'm going to be talking about the way in which Satan functions as a sort of symbol of queer resistance, or resistance based around sexuality and gender, and also the connection between demonization and race. So as Jonathan O'Donnell notes, there's an interrelation between demonology as a discursive tradition that posits the existence and activities of evil spirits and demonization as a socio-political reality, and which traits associated with those spirits, willful deviance, ontological invalidity, inevitable failure, are mapped onto real world populations. So what does this mean? Essentially, this idea, these demonologies, these conceptions of the demonic as active in the world that categorize the demonic in different ways often, there is an interconnection, an interrelation between these ideas of the devil and demonization as a socio-political reality and practice, in which particular groups of people, real world populations, are demonized, and in which they are associated with demonic traits such as willful deviance, the refusal to submit, ontological invalidity, the idea that their very existence is invalid, and also this idea of inevitable failure. If you demonize a group, if you literally demonize them, and we're not talking simply rhetorically here about demonization, we're talking about the radical dehumanization and demonization that goes on around sort of queer communities, and particularly in this period around race, where you have dehumanizing narratives such as that of the curse of Ham, where Black people are depicted and are discussed in theology, in theological narratives, as less than human, as of a different grouping. So you have this very literal demonization. And when you have this literal demonization and this parity being drawn between the demonic and particular people groups, you have a conception of their inevitable failure, because demons are doomed to fail. Whatever power they have in this world, within a Christian narrative, the end times will bring an end to their rule, bring an end to their power. And so these populations, which are viewed as demonized or are demonized, are viewed as those that will inevitably fail. Adam Kotzko's noticed, well, that the demonizer always needs the demon as a means of self-definition and self-legitimation. So in order to create a sense of an us, of an in-group, we demonize those who we wish to eject. So in other words, the demonic or the demonized are the ejected other of a sovereign unifying discourse, the idea of creating a singular discourse which explains the whole world and creates a group who are in, essentially. The creation of an us, an in-group, is facilitated by the demonization of a threatening other. So how do we define who we are as a solidified, sovereign, unified group? Well, we cast out, we have a demonized other. The demonic, therefore, is that which is rejected in order to shore up ideas and to protect the social order, the state, the church, a religious discourse or a religious kind of framework for understanding the world. But, and this is what O'Donnell suggests in their book, the demonic is inherently destabilizing, and the demonization process inherently destabilizes the group that attempts to demonize. It destabilizes the demonizer because it unveils the fractures inherent to the sovereign unity it demarcates. What do I mean by that? Well, essentially, that which you demonize, when you demonize a group, when you demonize an attribute even, the sort of the unified position, this orthodoxy, this hegemony in creating this demonization actually destabilizes itself. And there's two kind of key ways in which this happens. The first is through the radical similarity between groups. And we see this in the Satanic Depiction. If we are creating a sense of us and them, we're creating a sense of demonic and demonized and us, and the demonic is this sort of satanic figure. Well, what do we do with satanic figures who pass as human, who pass as angelic, who pass as divine? What do we do with figures who are so similar that it's almost impossible to tell the difference? Surely that destabilizes this sense of difference. It destabilizes that sense that we can easily demarcate between the demonic and ourselves. There's also the intractable persistence of the demonic. These groups which we attempt to eject, to other, and to demonize, they are not defeated by this ejection. They are not erased and annihilated by this ejection. There is an intractable persistence, much like there is for Milton Satan, who refuses to be defeated, because they continue to exist. They continue to persist. So what we're sort of talking about here is that demonization is a tactic by which we try to other others, but the demonizing of others, of these groups and identities, for example, creates within itself the seeds of the destruction of this idea of a sovereign unifying discourse and order. So we can see this dynamic at work in an easy example that everybody's quite familiar with. We have the L'Ange du Mal de Joseph Guiffe and the Guillaume Guiffe Le Génie du Mal. So if you don't know this story, which I'm presuming everybody does, but just in case, Joseph Guiffe was first commissioned to produce this depiction of Satan, L'Ange du Mal, for the cathedral in Liège. I'm not sure how to say it, sorry. But it was considered to be too sexy. Had an unhealthy beauty. And Guillaume Guiffe, it was his brother, who produced a second statue, which is in the cathedral. And as you can see, it's actually much sexier. But apart from that story, this is quite a good example of how demonization fails in its intent to eject the other. By demonizing this particular figure, by demonizing this idea of the seductive beauty, of carnal delight, there are essential problems. It doesn't do what we want it to do. It doesn't eject that sort of carnal interest. It doesn't eject that sexuality. Because you've encased it in stone, popped it in a church, and it does the exact opposite of what you wish it to do. It persists, essentially. And there's also the question of similarity. The similarities here between demonic and angel, which create this ambiguity and this slippage between the two. So you have a sort of example in sort of physical form here of how demonization fails in its object or is essentially unstable in attempting to reach its object. And you also see that happening in Milton's Paradise Lost. Milton, in creating Paradise Lost, is creating a narrative in which we see that Satan's seeming heroism is false and is rotten to the core. But the way in which Milton's Satan has been reread, reinterpreted, and reused ignores all of that and reproduces the heroic Satan. So you have the ways in which this this discourse, this kind of attempt to demonize the satanic has effectively done the opposite, unfortunately, and it's shown the fractures, shown the problems with the unifying discourse itself, with the divine discourse, if you will. So when we understand that, we can start to have a look at how in the 18th and early 19th century, depictions of the demonic, which are influenced by and borrowing from Milton's Satan, and particularly this idea of the sublime Satan, start to destabilize various sort of social norms. We see this in sexuality. So what's the history of the devil and sexuality? Well, the devil has frequently been connected to illicit or transgressive expressions of sexuality. You have this picture of a witch and a demon embracing. You also have the kind of incubus figure that we see in the Paris narrative there, the sort of the demon in the bed with the blue clad lady, who knows, maybe it is demonic color. But when you mix together this idea of the connection of the demonic and sexuality with this rewritten satanic figure, with this tragic anti-hero, with this Miltonic rebel, you'll begin to find the rewriting of this demonization of sexuality and the rewriting of demonic sexuality. So an example of this is found in Tamara by Lermontov, Mikhail Lermontov, the Russian writer. In brief, the story is that of a demon, an exile and a wanderer cast out who wanders the earth doing evil, not because he wishes it, but because he basically has no choice. There is, but he despises evil at the same time as enacting it. And he sees from a distance the figure Tamara, and he falls in love and eventually sort of wins her over, but with his kiss. So he killed her with his kiss, with his deadly poison of his kiss, immediately killed her. So you can read this as a moral tale about the dangers of demonic sexuality, the demonization of sexuality. But what we find in this kind of Miltonically influenced, or influenced by the rereading of Milton, depiction of the satanic figure, is a figure who did not wish to kill with his kiss, but rather was unable to kiss the woman that he loved without killing her because of the unjust punitive decrees of a tyrannical god. So here, what is being targeted, blamed, and essentially considered wrong or evil is not necessarily the sexuality itself, the kiss itself, but rather the tyrant who will not allow for his rejected subjects to love. Another example of rewriting demonic sexuality along sort of more clearly queer lines is found in Matthew Lewis's The Monk. You have the illustration there of the very sexy Satan hovering above Ambrosio, making a bit of a demonic deal. And as we can see from the depiction, there's an emphasis on this satanic figure as more beautiful than fancy's pencil ever drew. There is a loving amount of detail about this perfectly naked Satan. Now, Matthew Lewis's The Monk is replete with kind of homoerotic and homoromantic undertones, and nowhere is that clearer, I would say, than here, with this dwelling, this sexualized or eroticized dwelling on the form of the satanic figure. Now, this is a closeted text in that by the end of the novel, heteronormative reality is reinstated. All of the sort of subversive sexual elements are dead, and everybody gets married to somebody, men get married to women, women get married to men. And all of the sort of queer potential, the sort of gender ambiguity of Rosario and Matilda, the homoeroticism contained in this and other scenes is seemingly closed, removed from the narrative, eradicated, exorcised from the narrative. But is it? No, it's not. So I've highlighted the last line here. We have, however beautiful the figure, he could not but remark a wildness in the demon's eyes and a mysterious melancholy impressed upon his features, betraying the fallen angel and inspiring the spectators with secret awe. So the beauty of the devil is shown to be deceitful in the text. We get a later depiction of the devil. And this beauty is seen to be tempting and deceitful, but it's not only the beauty of the devil that attracts or entrances Ambrosio as a figure in this moment, it's also his sublimity. It's the wildness, the mysterious melancholy of the fallen angel, and that secret awe, all of which are sort of classics of that reread Miltonic Satan. And this sublimity persists through the narrative. So the attempt to eradicate and erase this queer sexuality is not quite successful. We also have the fact that this lovingly detailed depiction of an eroticized naked body is not eradicated by the text by reading. Every time we reread, we're confronted again with the same imagery. It is not eradicated or erased from the text by the narrative. It continues to be there. So it persists, if you will. So in this last section, I'm going to talk about racial demonization. So some content warnings here for discussions of anti-blackness and enslavement. I'm not going to go into much detail, but it's a relevant background to what we're going to be seeing in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. So this idea of racial demonization is one which is well documented and has existed over a very lengthy period of time. There's a relation between conjurations of the demonic and figurations of blackness. Now, as I've already mentioned, this is sort of part often of the radical dehumanization and demonization of groups of color, people of color, through narratives like the Curse of Ham, but also through the depiction of demonic figures as black, and also through sort of the literal naming black figures, black people, black actions as demonic. You find a really sort of bold example of this in the Scottish Gothic, where we have Robert Louis Stevenson's Throne Janet from the late 19th century. And he notes in his footnote that it was a common belief in Scotland that the devil appeared as a black man. And so although he does the work to sort of try and suggest that, oh, it's just this one black man who's a devil. Mr. Soothers had heard tell of black men many's the time, but there was something unco about this black man that daunted him. There was something eerie, something chilling about this particular man. So there's an attempt here to say, oh, it's not black men, it's this black man. But this attempt doesn't quite erase what we're seeing in the rest of the passage, and it doesn't erase this tradition. The passage opens with, and what should he find there but a man, or the appearance of a man, sitting in the inside upon a grave? This idea of seeing somebody who is a man or the appearance of a man, where does that uncertainty stem from? Does it stem from demonic interpretation, or does it stem from racialized discourse and dehumanization? And either could be true, reading that sentence on its own. We also have this idea, he was of great stature, black as hell, and his iron was singular to see. So also that connection between blackness and hell. So this black figure is intimately associated already with the demonic and hell more broadly. So we do have this racialized feature of demonization occurring in the period. Now, I'm going to have a quick look at a Gothic text and to ask, to what extent does the sort of mixing together of this racial demonization and this Miltonic register, to what extent can it possibly destabilize these narratives of racial demonization? And my answer is going to be not far, but we're going to see sort of what's going on there. So there's a couple of different examples of black devils within the Gothic more broadly. So this is from the chapbook, The Demon of Venice, which is the illegal chapbook, or the unallowed chapbook of the Fleur or the Moor by Charlotte Dacre, which has, as the title suggests, a Moor as a character who is designated as a Moor, as a demonic figure. But I'm more interested in discussing today the Isle of Devils by Matthew Gregory Lewis. So Matthew Lewis is most famous for The Monk, and his work, The Journal of a West Indian Propriety, is not that often discussed. The Isle of Devils is a metrical tale which is inset in The Journal of a West Indian Proprietor. There's an obvious correlation going on here. Matthew Lewis was an enslaver and an owner of plantations. And this journal of a Western proprietor was his journal of his time visiting the plantations that he owned. Inset into the middle of his journey is this tale of the Isle of Devils. And it's very clear that the demonic forms in it are racially coded. So let me just give you a brief kind of overview of the story. You have Irza, the Portuguese Catholic, shipwrecked on an island, the Isle of Devils. She's surrounded by small, impish, gurning creatures, and then rescued by the master fiend who scares them all off. He then takes her to his cave, or he sort of beckons for her to follow him to his cave. There is a scene of suggested or implicit in the text, it's rape. And she eventually has two children. So content warnings, there's going to be some child death in this as well, guys, at the end. And at the end of the narrative, she is rescued. But the devil has, within this narrative, the demonic figure has loved her, has been protected her, has been within his abilities kind to her. He loves his children very much and cares for them. He killed her boyfriend who tried to rescue her earlier because he saw him as a threat, not to him, to her. And at this sort of moment at the end where she abandons him and her children, where she is rescued, and there's those two different readings are layered on top of each other, he kills both of the children and himself by throwing himself into the sea. So that's the story. As I've already mentioned, it's quite clearly racially coded. We have the first appearance here. He's just rescued her. Almighty powers, a form, a gigantic as the palm, black as the storm, all shagged with her, wild, strange in shape and show, towered on the loftiest cliff and gazed below. With sort of the appearance of the demonic, we also have sexuality entering the text and staining the pure Eliza. So this obviously also ties in with racist conceptions around sort of demonic sexuality, the sexualized black male, sexualized male black body, sexualized black body, sexualized blackness more broadly. And we see that very much kind of tying in with what's occurring in this story. As I've already noted, the master fiend and the associate demons are coded and described in ways which overlap with racist descriptions of indigenous inhabitants and enslaved people. And the story also echoes elements of Lewis's diary accounts. And I think that we can potentially read this tale as him working through and confronting some of the realities with which he has been engaged. So one of the elements of the story which maps onto his own experience is this kind of the treatment of Irza by the demonic figure, where he beckons her towards his home and cautious he led her toward his lone abode and cleared each stone that might impede her road. So we have this idea of the helpful, servile demonic figure, which echoes Matthew Lewis's own writing on his experience of arriving at his plantation, where he was greeted to his surprise by many of the enslaved people there, very servilely and with apparent joy. It was only later, after considering this for a considerable amount of time and living there for a while, that he realized that this was a tactic of subversion and resistance. And that those who were most servile were those who least accepted the structures that were in place and their own enslavement. So we have this kind of mapping his experiences onto this racialized depiction of the demonic. So can we see this depiction as destabilizing racial demonologies in any way? I would argue that we can. I would say that the caveat is very much that there is a very extensive limitation on this, and also to suggest that it's not necessarily deliberate, because what we have with mixing this racial demonization with this metonic and sublime conception of the demonic is we have the inherent destabilization of these kind of hierarchies and hegemonies, of this settler colonial hegemony that is being described, or is being sort of which Irza is the avatar. So as I've said at the end, we have Irza leaving the island. And at this point, the demonic figure can't speak. Look, look, he seemed to say with action wild, look, mother, look, this babe is still your child. With him, as me, all social bonds you break, scorned and detested for his father's sake. My love, my service only wrought disdain, and nature fed his heart from yours in vain. Then go, ingrate, far o'er the ocean go, consign your friend, your child, to endless woe. Renounce us, hate us. Pleased, your course pursue, and break their hearts who lived alone for you. His eyes, which flashed red fire, his arms spread wide, her child raised high to heaven, too plain implied such were his thoughts, though nature speech denied. And now with eager glance the deep he viewed, and now the barge with savage howl pursued, then to his lips his infant wildly pressed, and fondly, fiercely clasped it to his breast. Three piteous moans, three hideous yells he gave, plunged headlong from the rock, and made the sea his grave. So you have here, in this moment of resistance and rejection, we have the moment at which this demonic figure fully, for the first time, attains sublimity in terms of his description, with this idea of his eyes which flash red fire, his arms widespread. He's no longer held back by this sort of servile attitude or this devotion, but instead attains a sort of formal sublimity. And so we also have here in this moment a discourse of rejection and rebellion and resistance. It's Irza here that becomes the monstrous figure, able to abandon her friends and abandon her children. So this sort of passage bears within itself a subversion of the sort of settler colonial narrative that Irza has and which dominates the text more broadly. But the limitations on it are the fact that Matthew Lewis is incapable of imagining this rebellion as successful, because to imagine this rebellion as successful, he would have to imagine both himself and the structures with which he is extremely complicit as the structures in need of destruction. So we have this sort of sense in which the mixing of racial demonologies and the Miltonic Satan can destabilize these hegemonic narratives of colonial settlerism, settler colonialism. But they are limited by the white imagination. And it's only when we look at sort of far more modern, really, Black iterations of resistance and subversion using demonic figures that we can see this sort of inherent destabilization coming to fruition. So I'm going to end this part, come out, stop recording, and see if anyone has any questions. So in this section, we're going to be looking at three modern examples, and we're going to be thinking about how these sort of legacies of subversion and this idea of Satan in the cultural imaginary has developed, and the sort of proliferation of different depictions that we've got today and what they're doing. The first clip that we're going to be watching is from The Prophecy. If you've not seen it, the basic argument or the basic sort of plot of the film is that there are fallen angels, including Lucifer, but they're also rebel angels who are not confined to hell, but they're also not allowed back in heaven, and they've rebelled against God because they don't want humans basically to get the things that they think should belong to them. So we'll play this scene, it's only a couple of minutes, and then discuss kind of the subversions that are going on here and how this ties back to these traditions of satanic depiction as well. Oh, if you can't hear it, somebody just shout out that you can't hear. So, hopefully, as you could see there, we have not an inversion of the order, but a complete sort of destabilization of it, that we have these three sort of combative forces that force the demonic and the divine into allegiance. And what we sort of effectively have in The Prophecy is a demonizing of the divine. So in the depiction, there are certain elements that borrow from this sort of satanic tradition. We have the really unsettling sensuality and sexuality of Viggo Mortensen in that part. But we also have this sort of interrogation of the relationship between the demonic and the divine that we find in Milton. Here, this sort of similarity between the divine and the demonic, between their aims and between their powers, serves to not deify or divinitize the devil, who doesn't become in any sense good in that section. Instead, we find a demonization of the divine. There's a demonic alliance with the divine plan. The demonic is not subservient to the divine plan, which we find frequently in sort of theological and historical narratives, that the devil can't help working according to the divine plan. No, in this text, we have a demonic willed alliance, which is entered into voluntarily with the divine plan, which is an inherently subversive alliance because, as we already mentioned, it demonizes the divine. There's also in this text a demonic human alliance against a group of rebel angels, but that sort of overlap of demonic and human interest destabilizes that sort of idea of a divine demonic binary with humans choosing between the two. This decision, humans choose to align themselves with both the demonic and the divine plan at the same time. The divine order and sovereign, the idea of sovereign unity is also unsettled while ostensibly defending it. Because while the film ends with a return to a narrative of faith, which seems to sort of reinsert or reinscribe the divine order, the sovereign unity of God over the creation, the fact that this divine order was only reinstated due to a demonic alliance, an alliance which was explicitly not engaging in the actions for the same reasons as the divine, unsettles that conception of the integrity of the divine order. We also have, interestingly, an inversion of the sort of relationship between the devil and the divine to freedom and captivity and power and powerlessness. In this case, it's the devil who is free both to act and to will, whereas God is held captive to his own decrees. And the devil has power to act, whereas God is once again powerless within this framework. Okay, a second text to quickly look at. Now, I'm very aware that this is the Good Omens film, not the book. So I'm discussing the Good Omens TV series here as a text and what it's doing as something that is interacting in its own right with the cultural imaginary. I'm also aware that Crowley is not the devil. There is a demonic figure played by a massive red Benedict Cumberbatch. But what we have in the Crowley figure is sort of the replacement of Satan in multiple pivotal scenes in the biblical narrative, including the temptation of Jesus in the desert and, of course, the serpent apple scene. So Crowley essentially fulfills a devilish function and certainly a demonic function. Now, the ways in which this text works is that this sort of beautiful figure frequently, certainly depending on your point of view, seductive figure of Crowley conforms to kind of the rebellious archetype that we find in Milton's Satan, or in the rereading of Milton's Satan. And it plays a key role in destabilizing the theological narratives around key biblical scenes. In episode 3, of the TV series, you have the sort of prehistory of Aziraphale and Crowley. And you have this scene in the Garden of Eden where Crowley asks the question, well, did I actually do God's will by tempting them to eat the apple? And you did the opposite by giving them the sword that you weren't meant to give them. And the question itself raises a theological quandary. Is the devil's temptation of Adam and Eve to eat the apple, and is the fall of man essentially both inevitable and potentially predestined? Is it in line with God's plan? Other scenes include Noah's Ark, where it's Crowley who forms the voice of conscience and reason against an arbitrary God asking, but not the kids, right? He's not going to kill the kids. And then at the scene of the crucifixion, we have a rewriting of the demonic temptation in the desert of Jesus, where Crowley, when asked why he did it, responds, well, you know, he's a carpenter's son. He wasn't going to get the chance to travel. So instead of this being a scene of temptation, it's a sign of sympathy with a figure who is going to become a martyr to a tyrant. We also, so we're basically getting a slippage here between the demonic and the divine, and also we're getting a radical unity happening. This is particularly evident in the body swap that occurs in the last episode of the season between Aziraphale and Crowley. Not only are they sort of unified in purpose, they are also sort of radically indistinguishable at that point. This brings me to one of my favourite pet theories, queer shipping as subversive theology. So queer shipping of these characters involves rereading the text for those destabilizations of hegemonic meaning, for those cracks in the sort of divine narrative, which are very much a part of the text. But this process of queer shipping is a process of discovering these fractures and destabilizations. And particularly in the case of Aziraphale and Crowley, because they can be, and arguably, well, I won't say should be, but they can be, because everybody can read them the way they prefer to, but they can be read as asexual figures and gender variants. So they can also be read not only as, or queer shipped as a form of subversive theology, which questions not only sort of cis heteronormative patriarchal structures, but also allo normative structures as well. So the last text that I'm going to briefly look at is going to be Montero. Now, if you follow me on Twitter, you'll know I did a thread about this and received a lot of kickback. It seemed to be very controversial. And I think what we see in this video is a reclaiming of demonization narratives, both the demonization of the queer and the demonization of racialized demonization. But it was interesting to see the amount of kickback that this got in comparison to other demons in popular culture at the moment. We have a whole TV series about the devil as a detective. We have Billie Eilish's demonic imagery. We have Panic at the Disco's demonic imagery, all of which receive some measure of kickback. But I would argue that the reclaiming of demonization in this text along those multiple lines of marginalization, and particularly conjunction of racialized demonization and queer demonization is what caused the reaction. But we'll quickly sort of watch it and then discuss what it's doing, and that will be the end of the session.
In life, we hide the parts of ourselves we don't want the world to see. We lock them away. We tell them no. We banish them. But here, we don't. Welcome to Montero. I caught it bad just today. You hit me with a call to your place. Ain't been out in a while anyway. Was hoping I could catch you throwing smiles in my face. Romantic talking, you don't even have to try. You're cute enough to fuck with me tonight. Like,
so, to what extent how can we understand this video and this narrative, and to what extent can we view it as reclaiming demonization? So in the video, what we have is clearly the sort of alignment of the satanic with this conception of freedom of expression and freedom of identity, a rejection of those narratives which demonize, and a rejection of those structures which confine. So the question becomes, to what extent can you reclaim a demonization in this way? So Kotzko notes that this is what the modern rebels who identify with the devil miss. Even the devil is shaped by the divine order he rejects. In other words, if we use the devil as a figure of resistance, we still reinscribe or revalidate or center these narratives of divine order, as it were, these normative structures. O'Donnell sort of reposits this as a positive, suggesting that it's perhaps precisely this that gives this identification its force, situating objects within and against the structures of sovereign power, working to deracinate and to deconstruct those structures while acknowledging one's ineluctable enmeshment with them. In other words, we use the tools of those who demonize in order to situate ourselves both within and against those structures and ideologies, ideas, theologies, and demonologies. We recognize that we are enmeshed in those systems, we reject our placement within them, and we imagine our identity against them. I want to go a sort of step further in questioning what we can do in terms of both reclaiming and resisting demonization. The question becomes, what happens if we kill the devil? As we get at the end of the video there. So within the video, you have this identification with the satanic. You have then the descent into hell. You have the seduction of the demonic. And then you have the eradication. You have the killing of the demonic. And this isn't a disavowal of those temptations and expressions. But what I would argue that this does is to move us beyond the narrative in which we are enmeshed, or attempt to do so, that in refusing the divine and in killing the demonic, we refuse to be identified, structured, and defined by these narratives, which are being produced by hegemonic order, and by this particularly Christianized hegemonic order. So that would be how I would end. On a lovely little gift for you there, I guess. And any questions?